Hello, Australia. Welcome to another big episode of The Couch, 7:15 to be exact. Today, we've got a very special performer. His name is Jared, and we'll know him as Young Elvis. So if you haven't seen Elvis in the place for a while, he's in the building. Stay tuned for that. Talking Property with Steve Collins. He's got a couple of guests with us today. Rob Druid, of course, and Miguel De Freitas. They're talking about lots of things property. And later on, talking movies. Paul Elwin is in with four brand new movies. We've got the cast, can I say, the lead actor for a TV show. It's a children's TV show on the ABC called Itch. We're talking to Sam Ireland and Keela Kern. They are brother and sister on the show. We'll talk to them very soon. Talking WA heritage and art and fashion with Karen Young. And Sammy is with her today, Sammy Wayborn. She's an amazing Indigenous artist. And later on, talking entertainment with Alexander Sacosta. I think that's a big show. I think that's enough for now. 7:15 starts now.
It's showtime on the couch. Hey, it's showtime on the couch. You can see it from your house. You can see it from your house. It's showtime on the couch. And the best in town. You can see it from your house. Yeah, it's showtime on the couch. Oh, oh.
Hello, Australia. Can I say hello to our friends in New South Wales and Victoria? Freedom has come upon you, and I hope you're having a great time being out there and about and living life. I'm not too sure. I think Canberra's got the freedom as well. The Prime Minister's away, so while he's away, you've got freedom anyway in Canberra. So thank you for your company and all those people in Perth, the Northern Territory, Tasmania, Alice Springs, anywhere in Australia. If I've missed you, South Australia, thank you to Steve. Welcome to the program, and please stick with us for the next hour. And you heard that famous voice. It isn't Guess Who. It's actually Steve Collins. He's talking property. Over to you, Steve.
Well, thanks very much, Fred. Yes, we've got Rob Druitt with us, as usual. And we've also got Miguel De Freitas from De Freitas and Ryan. He's filling in for Rod today. He's Rod's business partner. And Miguel, you are an expert, or you specialise in commercial property. So for those people out there that might be thinking about starting a small business, maybe a sandwich shop, or maybe they need a small factory unit or something because it's a tradie or whatever, what is the difference between renting a house to live in and renting a commercial property from which to do your business?
Well, the basic difference is one you reside in and one you run a business from.
Yep.
With a commercial tenancy, there isn't an act of Parliament like the Residential Tenancies Act, yep, which covers residential leases, but it's more common law. And in a commercial lease, commercial tenants pay for all the outgoings, so they pay council rates.
What do you say, all the council rates?
Water rates, insurance, land tax. There's a bigger responsibility where someone that lives in a rental house, basically you pay the rent, you pay your water consumption and your power, and that's about it. So that's really the main difference.
So really, does it mean that with a residential property, the landlord has got more responsibilities? So if you own a commercial property and you rent it out, you really just don't have to worry about it all that much. Is that true?
That's true. The onus is on the tenant, and even to ensure that they comply with all statutory requirements, being Water Corp, being council, and they ensure that they practices all conform.
And what if, say, I wanted to start a sandwich shop and I found the premises I want? What do I have to go through to enable to rent that shop, and what period, is there a minimum period that I would have to take it for?
Say you want to start up a lunch bar in an industrial area. So the first basic thing that you've got to look at, you know, is it council approved? Is there a grease trap? Because they're the most basic requirements that you need.
And you need to put those in as a tenant, is that right?
If they're not in place, you have to. And you got to make sure that you do get your approvals, because sometimes being in a commercial area doesn't ordinarily mean that you can just open up a lunch bar.
Right, okay. That's fascinating. So there is really a great difference between commercial and residential, more than just the fact that you're participating in a business from a commercial property, but your responsibilities are far greater than if you're just living in a house or an apartment or whatever.
Yeah, it's very different, very different. It's still real estate, but it's just a different type of real estate.
Yeah, okay. And Rob, On Talking Property, a couple of weeks ago, we spoke to Dr. Carl Mellon from Climate Evaluation, and it was a most fascinating talk because he's an environmentalist, and at the moment we've got that they're preparing for the big climate change meeting over in Glasgow, so it's probably appropriate to talk about this. We found out by speaking to Carl that all of the banks and all the insurance companies, they're right into climate change.
Well, they know.
And
know
what he has with climate evaluation, you go on his website and you put in your address, and that can tell you how either the value of your property or what insurance potentially you can or cannot get for your property based on how climate change may affect it. That was a fascinating talk, wasn't it?
It's a really interesting subject. And, you know, we talk about valuations of real estate and you think, oh, the value of the property. But now we're talking about valuation from a climate perspective and how that's impacting upon property. So the banks, of course, they're very concerned about it because they've got the security over the property.
For 30 years, mate.
For 30 years. So they're thinking forward many years and thinking, well, with climate change and the acceleration of climate activities, which are creating a lot of issues with insurance, and I'm sure a lot of the viewers will know about their insurance going up considerably over the last couple of years. So quite fascinating when you're thinking about buying a property, what is the climate, potential climate impact in the future? And of course, that's the way to find out.
And recently we've had, well, the bushfires, of course, come to mind. Yeah. There's also, we've had floods, we get that. If you live near a beach, particularly in New South Wales and places like that, a lot of the houses in Narrabeen and a northern beach.
There's been some very scary footage, hasn't there, of houses right on the precipice.
That's exactly right. And what they're actually building 7-metre walls now in front of those buildings, which is costing them $300,000 each. But that's what this climate evaluation does. You go there and it tells you, well, you're in a flood zone, you're in a bushfire zone, or your house is perfectly safe.
Yeah, so it'll give you a bit of an idea as to the potential risk with your property. I mean, there's areas in right across the country which are low-lying areas where potentially there could be flooding, of course, and, of course, bushfire, as you mentioned, is one of the big ones as well. So just another thing to be very mindful of when you're buying a property.
When you're buying a property.
And particularly a rural property and in regional areas.
Does commercial, does rural property come under commercial, Miguel, or is that entirely different?
No, it's a different kettle of fish, rural property. Yeah, no, it's commercial's basically where you run a business.
Yep.
So,
but the farm is a business as well.
It is, but it's the zoning is rural, so you can't have animals in a commercial property.
Right.
Where you can, and even with rural properties.
There goes my ideas to start a pet shop.
But even with rural property, you still need to get council approval for for the commercial arrangements that you have and what type of business that you do have as well.
Okay. Yeah. And Rob, yeah, you've been out and about. You've been at an auction today. This is why you're all dolled up. But how is the market going? Has it levelled out a little bit? Because it was boom there for a long time, wasn't it?
On the West Coast here, no. It's moving ahead as it is on the East Coast. And this is quite fascinating. In my 30 years of real estate, I've never seen the entire country, both regional and capital cities, all moving forward at the same time. But, of course, underlying this, we've got these very low interest rates.
Yep.
Interesting factor in the last week was the inflation and the potential for the rates to start nudging up. Yep. So it'll be interesting to see how that affects the market coming weeks.
Sorry, have you noticed that the banks are starting to lock in their long-term interest rates? Have you noticed
that? Very much so, yeah. Those cheap 4-5 year rates are long gone. Mm-hmm. 3-year rates are now creeping up to 2.5% and above percent, maybe up to 2.75%. And the shorter rates, two years, are also starting to creep up. So it had to happen at some stage. Not a major difference. And, of course, the Reserve Bank's still saying no rate increases until 2024. But that doesn't stop the banks increasing the rates themselves.
I've never known banks to increase rates, boys. This is news to me. Yes. Miguel de Freitas and Rob Druitt from Druitt and Shed, First National, and Miguel de Freitas from De Freitas and Ryan, thanks for joining us on Talking Property again today.
Thank you.
Well done. Thank you very much to Steve. Steve, what's the website for people to catch your podcast as
well? Oh, we go to talkingproperty.net.au or we go to Podbean Talking Property.
There you go. You can go to that one. And we look forward to having you guys back next year on the couch talking property again. So thank you very much, Steve, and thanks to the team as well. We'll look out for Brabham next year. I'm hoping it will go up in value.
It will now.
Interesting. Well, let's hope the interest rates don't ever go up to 17 or 18%. Hopefully, the trend could take us 20 years, hopefully. But thank you very much. Now, someone that never changes is our next guest. Now, can I just say, before we introduce them, really important that Australia vaccinates. We need people to be double vaccinated. Very soon, there will be restrictions around Australia on what you can and can't do if you're not vaccinated. So before we introduce Nick and Frank, I just want to say to you, please go out and vaccinate so we can all be one country, one law, one rule, one nation, one happy person at Christmas as well. Well, for you, actually. Here's Nick and Frankie doing a bit of comedy.
Hey, what a great introduction by Fred.
He always does great.
Listen, he's looking really, really well.
Do you know, I reckon Fred's looking well because we're back on the show.
Well, I actually heard that he's looking well because he'd been running around the park. He's looking really
well. I thought it was a kite sailing.
Well, that explains the tan, of course. But listen, we're here to do the song, The COVID Blues, which we wrote a couple of weeks ago.
I love that song. I've got something that's going to make this song even better.
You're going to make it even better, eh? Yeah. This old thing.
Yeah.
Now, listen.
I thought you'd throw it away.
I thought you threw it away.
No, it's perfect for this song.
It's got a gaffer and things are hanging off it.
Well, it's getting old.
It's hands day.
No, no. Yeah.
You look ridiculous, by the way, in that thing.
Look, I'm playing COVID-19. I've got the COVID. That stays.
All right, so now you're Nick the Noise COVID-19,
and look at the corona of receptors I've got. See if I can get your eye. Boing!
All right, so, okay, so you're a bug.
No, I'm a virus. A virus, not a bug, a virus.
You're a virus.
I am. I'm a virus.
You're bugging me right now. I get a bit tipped right now.
That's what COVID's supposed to do. It's supposed to bug you. But now I've got gain of function. I can actually play the bugle.
No, you can't.
I can.
Not even with gain of function can you play the bugle.
Watch this.
Give it a big tip.
See?
Yeah, no, well, you haven't gained much. I'll give you the big tip right there.
Yeah, well, with gain of function, I can now play double bass.
Oh. That's not too bad, actually. Is that it?
That's
all
it.
All right, get on with the song then.
Oh, no, I got more. I can hit the cowbell.
Well, you don't need gain of function to be able to hit a cowbell.
Well,
I'll give you the big tip right now. All right, so read through this song. All right, so let me get this right then.
Right.
So you're Nick the Noise, COVID-19.
Correct.
And apparently you can leap 1.7 metres.
1.7 metres now because I've got gain of function.
Mm-hmm. And you've got gain of function.
I have, tick.
Yes, and you can play the...
Double bass.
The double bass.
Tick.
And you can play the cowbell.
I've done that.
Mm-hmm. And you can also play the bugle.
I can,
apparently.
All of that.
All
now,
of that.
Just remember,
yes.
I'm very dangerous. I can make you very, 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 very sick.
I'll tell you something. Even before you became Nick the Noise COVID-19, you've been making me very, 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 very sick. All right, can we get on with the song?
What? I can sing. Maria, Maria. Maybe not.
Is that gain of function?
No, that's just my raw talent.
All right, let's get on with this song then.
Okay.
You ready?
I'm ready. I got gain of function, you know.
Well, I woke up this morning, I was feeling fine. I made it to the toilet in the nick of time. I turned on the TV to the morning news show, but they weren't telling me what I wanted to know. I was disappointed, I was so confused, cause I needed a little more COVID news. Yeah, gimme that COVID news. Don't know what I'm gonna do if they don't give me any more COVID news. I'm gonna slip right into the COVID news. Yeah, gimme more COVID news. Yeah, I need to hear a little more about the jabs and how many vaccinations must I have. Will I need a booster to get me through? And can you tell me more about the mandate too? I am disappointed, I'm so confused, cause I need a little more COVID news. Yeah, gimme that COVID news. I don't know what I'm gonna do, cause I don't have any more COVID news. I know I'm gonna blow a fuse. Yeah, gimme more COVID news. Right, you ready? Here we go. Do
And what about the borders? Are they gonna stay closed? Do I need a road map out of my woes? Will I need to find more? I don't really know, cause I'm not really sure. I am disappointed, I'm so confused, cause I need a little more COVID news. Yay, gimme that COVID news. I don't know what I'm gonna do if I don't get me any more COVID news. I'm gonna slip right into the COVID blues. Gimme more COVID news. Yay! Gimme more COVID news.
One more time, Nick.
Yeah, gimme more COVID news.
Wow, that was
the first time we've actually made a song without any bullshit at all, eh?
All right, now you can take that thing and you can throw it in the bin, all right, because we'll never use it again.
I'm going to give it an injection and it won't be alive much longer.
That's great.
Thank you, Fred.
Welcome. Thank you very much to you too, Nick. Thank you, guys. You can leave now. Thank you very much. Turn off their microphones. Yeah, that's probably a good thing. And I'm not around the park and I wasn't exercising. I wouldn't do that. Thank you very much. But we'll get double vaccinated, so should you, folks. Thank you very much. Paul, welcome to the program. Nice to have you here.
It's good to be in, yes.
And we're talking movies. Now, this is our last movie segment for 2021.
Yes.
You've been with us all year. I'm been really glad to have you back.
Yeah, it's been
great. I hope you come back next year.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there's heaps of great movies going
to
be,
and we're
going to
do streaming as well.
It's huge,
which is great. But we've got four great movies today.
Yeah, well,
Paul,
we're done with October, we're done with Halloween, and we're done with Getting Scared. So now we've got like some big name blockbuster movies coming in.
We do actually.
They're huge. Some
Eternals.
Big name actors in these. Eternals, not the Eternals. It's Eternals.
Eternals.
This is all Marvel. This is Marvel Cinematic Universe. This is all from the comics. This is huge. Eternals. The whole comic story is the Celestials, which are these mega beings in the universe, created an army of Eternals, who are technically like the good guys, and also an army of evil people called the Deviants. This is the story of the Eternals. These Eternals, this group of Eternals, have been on Earth for quite some time, and they've actually been observing and dabbling with a few aspects of what humans do, I guess, in regards to like civilization and everything. Apparently they were involved in shaping everything, these characters here. And everyone was like, well, what were they doing when Thanos was here? And apparently Thanos is related to one of these characters as well.
No.
It's huge. This is a story about them.
Okay.
Few big names in this one. We've got Angelina Jolie in this. We've got Salma Hayek in this. A cool one. Gemma Chan from Crazy Rich Asians. Mm-hmm. She's in this as well. Kumail Nanjiani, he was in The Big Sick. I remember him from Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. The cool thing was, they told him, hey, you're in this movie. And he's like, well, I'm not built like, you know, a superhero. And they said, well, you know, it's going to be a few months until that. 3 months, he was working out like, you know, flat stick, just working out, getting buff. He looked insane. Yeah. He was tweeting it and everyone was going like, what the heck? We didn't expect you to look like this. He looked amazing. But then all the shooting was delayed because of COVID and all of that. And he's like going, he kept working out. So he was like in the mode for that long. Yeah, he was like totally buff in this movie. And everyone's going, wow, he's done so well in this. But we've got like, you know, Angelina Jolie, Salma Hayek in this
cast.
One. Amazing.
Eternals comes out 4th of November, doesn't it?
Very big. So this is the 26th MCU movie. And this will be the last one for the year until...
Yep. Next year.
Yeah, next year's huge ones, yes.
Now, Red Notice is going to be out as well on the 4th of November. That's another one, a big one.
Red Notice. This is action comedy. Some huge names in this one. I like the fact what it is an Interpol agent is hunting for one of the world's biggest thieves.
It's got The Rock in it.
She's dressed in red, and I kept thinking, oh, is this Carmen Sandiego? It feels like an updated version of Carmen Sandiego. Of course, well, who's going to play the thief? We've got Gal Gadot. Wonder Woman as the thief, and who's going to be chasing? Oh, I guess Ryan Reynolds. And who's he going to be teaming up with? Dwayne Johnson. So you've got these three huge names. It was reported that each of them is going to get $20 million.
Is that all?
The movie cost $200 million to make. They're getting $20 million each from this movie.
Wow.
This movie's huge.
It's a Netflix
going around
film,
the world.
By the way.
It's a Netflix film. Netflix hasn't thrown out this much money towards a film for quite some time. And they're traveling around the world. all these big names. Gal Gadot is the bad guy in this one, so she's the thief and they're chasing her around the world. So this is kind of, I guess, like if you still, you know, feel that you want to have a bit more of a James Bond thing, but a bit more comedy in it.
You've got a great cast.
And amazing cast. Woman, and I've always Ryan wanted to Reynolds. See like the likes of these three in the one movie and see how their chemistry
I would have loved together. To have worked with them because I reckon there would have been a laugh, all three of
especially,
them together.
I mean, especially like Ryan Reynolds. He's just comedic all the time. So that's Red Notice.
4th of November.
4th of November.
The Power of the Dog.
This one's a bit dramatic. It's not exactly the Wild West era. This is like 1925, but in the West, and it's involving a rancher. This one is a Western drama. This was directed by Jane Campion, who had a few quite big films. Her biggest one ever was The Piano, which won like a multitude of Academy Awards. It's got her style all over it because she's from New Zealand. It's got that sort of bleak style to it. Benedict Cumberbatch is the main character in this. He's playing Phil Burbank, who is a rancher, and he's a really mysterious character because like the whole town knows of him. You know, he's a bit larger than life, and the whole thing is all of a sudden his brother comes home saying like, you know, I've been away for so long, I have a wife and this is her son and everything, and he's like, who's this? And the wife is played by Kirsten Dunst, and
another
all of a sudden
actress.
And Benedict Cumberbatch, perfect American accent in this, just amazing enigmatic kind of guy. I mean, he's Doctor Strange, Sherlock,
movie.
He does all of that, but in this one, like, he's just really solemn and he's got that sort of that Western vibe in it, The Power of the Dog.
Comes out 11th of November. The final one today is The Rescue. Now, this is a documentary.
Yes.
Amazing doc. We all know about the Thailand.
Well, the whole thing is with this one, this was back in 2018, so not that long ago.
No.
18 days during June and July in 2018, the whole world was focused on northern Thailand, the Tamwang Cave. 12 kids from a soccer team and their coach, they were trapped in this cave. Huge thing. This doco, amazing, dramatic. A lot of never seen footage is in this as well, interviewing a lot of people.
This is all real too, isn't it?
It's not a movie. All the footage, everything, but they craft this doco so well because it is dramatic, because this is 18 days. There was two deaths from Thailand Navy SEALs in this one as well. I mean, everyone remembers like Elon Musk had a bit of a tiff with one of the scientists when he suggested he could come up with a solution. It's like, that won't work. This was 18 days. This captured the news for so long and everyone was like, you know, fearing so much the situation of it
as
well.
This will be a great one to watch leading up to Christmas. 18th of November, it's called The Rescue.
The Rescue, yes.
Anything else you want to say about the movies we looked at today?
No, I mean,
when's Spider-Man coming out?
That's next year. It's big, but like there's no more trailers or anything for that for quite some time.
And is there another Wonder Woman? Have I heard there's another Wonder Woman coming?
They're starting to write it, I believe, and no one's given any clues as to what it is. Everyone's going, well, last one was 84, so do you want a 90s one or something? And they said it can be anything. And
fantastic.
This will be probably the last Wonder Woman.
Well, I tell you what, to go and watch these wonderful movies next month, I have been given by Palace Cinema 5, not just one, but 5 of the Palace Cinema Gold Lounge, or Platinum as we call it at Palace, tickets for you to go and watch the movies. If you haven't been to Palace Cinema, check out the way it looks. You can expect something looking very similar to this. There's a lot of red wine. There's a beautiful cocktail lounge there. Parking, only $5. Take your ticket with you from the car park underneath and up to the cinema. They'll stamp it and you'll only pay $5. Great movies, great cinemas, leather seating, very luxurious. We'd love you to win. All you got to do to win is send us an SMS. Please do it from anywhere in Australia, because now that you're all open, you can go to a palace right near you and use these tickets. You need an SMS, the code word, which is PALACE, P-A-L-A-C-E, PALACE. Easy, 0439-929-99. Please include your name and your address. So not just the word PALACE, we need your name and address, because how do we post you the tickets if you win? Thank you very much to Palace Cinema for doing that and for helping us this year. And we look forward to having your company next year. Paul, thank you as well.
Thanks,
you've been great with the streaming and the films you've been looking at. And Paul will be back with us hopefully next year. And we hope that you're back with us after this break for more of The Couch. We're talking Itch from the ABC TV show. Join us after the break. See you then. We'll be right back. Welcome back to The Couch. It's always a pleasure to introduce other locally made television. Itch is a great show on the ABC. It's in its second series today. We've got two of the cast. And can I say, we don't go cheap. We've got the leading actor and actress. We call them actors because they are wonderful. We've got Itch and we've got your sister, Chloe.
Yes.
But your real names are Sam and Kiala.
Yes.
Yes.
I got that right. I said just like Koala, but Kiala. Welcome to The Couch. Thanks for being here today.
Thanks for having us.
It's a pleasure, yeah.
First of all, do you think it's a buzz working in television? Is it something that you've always dreamed of doing?
100%.
Yeah, yeah, I think absolutely.
What's been the best thing about getting into a TV show and working in Perth, your own city?
Oh, man, it's so many things. Just the experience of seeing a team like that, the cast and crew working on a production of that scale.
And this was your first, wasn't it?
Yes.
Sam?
Yep.
Did you have any knowledge of anything that you had, how it worked, apart from watching TV?
I did an indie feature film before, but that was very different pace. And I remember being really scared on the first day. It was definitely a big adjustment period for me, but you sort of find your footing as you go. But yeah, I'd done nothing quite like it.
You're a university student, but you went to uni?
Yes, yeah, I did. I studied theatre at Curtin University. Yep. I studied that full time for a couple years, did a 1 year diploma at Whopper, and then went back to Curtin. And
were you always planning on being an actor? Is that what you've always wanted to be? When you were a kid, did you do, pantomime and theatre at school?
I was always fascinated by stories. I originally wanted to be an author, but my sister sort of talked me into doing drama in high school because she thought I'd like it, and I got obsessed.
What about yourself, Kiala? I know you're a little bit younger.
Yeah, I am.
Can I ask your ages? I know, Sam, how old are you?
Yes, I'm 23, turning 24 next month.
And Kiala?
I'm 15.
15. So for you, you still haven't worked out what you want to be, but you're probably enjoying the ride on a television program.
It's amazing. It's always through the audition processes as well, just the call you get when you got the role. That's just amazing feeling.
It would be amazing. But I think it's wonderful because we live in Perth. Perth is pretty far away. We've been great because of COVID not being here.
Yeah.
We've been allowed to get on with what we had to do. But it's a buzz making television over here that the rest of Australia can watch nationally. We do it every week. And I guess you guys feel the same.
Yeah.
Yes.
The pressure's on us to showcase WA.
That's
now,
it.
Now, those people who don't know, Itch was made in Denmark and Albany, wasn't it? And,
yeah.
And some in the studios were at the ABC.
Yes. We were split between down south and in Perth. But yeah, particularly the first series was a lot in Albany.
How long did it take to record the first?
The first one, I think, was 8 weeks in Albany and 2 or 3 weeks in Perth.
What a holiday.
Yeah, it was amazing.
Do they look after you? They give you food?
Yes, everything.
It's just a beautiful, beautiful place.
Luxury hotels.
Yeah. That's right. It was very luxurious.
How do I get into Itch? The third series. Obviously, 8 weeks is a long time to spend in Albany.
Yeah.
And did you have your families with you? Because you're quite young. I mean, obviously, Itch is a little bit older.
Yeah. So I had my mum with me down there. Yeah. And in fact, in the first season, we managed to... Oh, no, the second season, we managed to bring our dog as well. Mm. So,
you've got to have your dog.
Yeah, and we managed to fly back every couple of weeks when I wasn't in for a couple of days or something. So it was
At some of the footage you can see on screen at the moment. You've done some exciting stuff, a lot of blowing up.
Yes.
For those people who don't know what the whole gist behind Itch is, it's basically science, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's right.
Tell me a little bit about the plot and the storyline.
So Itch is a high school student. He loves chemistry and he's trying to collect all the elements on the periodic table. And in the first series, this obsession leads him to purchasing this rock, which turns out to be this entirely new element that is super radioactive and dangerous, but this incredible power source. And this corrupt organization get wind of it and start to chase him. And he has to try and run and protect it with the help of his friends and family.
Yeah.
And the second series sort of builds on the consequences of that, I think.
So we've had the first, we've started the second one, I think it was in early October.
Yes.
People can watch both series on iView, on the ABC iView, so you can catch up basically.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like I did the other day, I went on and it's all in high definition, looks great, great quality, beautiful surroundings, can I say.
Oh, yeah.
You had some great weather in a lot of the storylines I saw.
Yes. And in fact, sometimes there was really bad weather, so we'd have to pretend it was really sunny and we'd be
How do they do that?
It's just raw willpower.
You just wear
willpower.
No clothes. Yeah. You wear shorts and a t-shirt and look like you're hot.
Yeah, freezing weather.
They tell you think warm thoughts.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess that can work. Like being in a studio, television studio. The best thing about being on television for you guys, individually, can I ask you first, Carla?
I'd have to say it's probably the rush and being able to work with every one of your friends and just building a bigger community. It's so fun.
Your school friends? How do they sort of react to
it? Well, I don't know. I don't really talk about it that much, to be honest.
You've left them all.
Very, very low-key with it. Humble. But when I do tell people about it, they're all really interested in it and they love talking about it, which is
they're
awesome.
They're probably very proud of you as well. And then you'll get a lot of the people that will go, I know her.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I'm now related to her. And what about yourself, Itch? Or can I say Sam?
Yeah. Oh man, it's the whole experience was awesome. Mm. What's been really special is, you know, because it's TV made for younger people. Mm-hmm. When you meet those fans,
all right,
and
I won't
those
watch
connections.
Anymore.
Yeah, no. It's, I hope everyone enjoys it, but you know, like,
look, it is made for people between what ages would you say?
Yeah, I think officially they say 8 to 12 years old. I think is the key audience.
But you know what? It's like watching cartoon, those movies with you know, the characters are 3G, whatever you call those, the new type of cartoons. It's made for adults to sort of latch onto.
Absolutely. I think the strength of the show is that it doesn't talk down to its audience. It stays grounded and serious.
And you've got a great cast. Can we say some of the names that are working with you? Go on, let's test your knowledge.
We've got Kyla, we've got Mel,
Harrison. Charles Russell.
Are they all great? You can tell us because no one's watching.
Yeah. It's a stellar cast to
Who's
work with.
Who's the worst to work with? Come on, Kiala. Is he good to work with on the show? Does he make a lot of mistakes?
It's been tough. No, he's great. Yeah. We have a fun time on and off screen as well.
A lot
Kiala's
of outtakes.
Kiala's awful, though.
Yeah. Look, it's okay.
Is it hard being brother and sister and then leaving the set? Because everywhere you go, most people, we all do it. I've been calling you Itch, and I know your name's Sam, Kiala. Of course, that's you. What's it like playing brother and sister and then leaving the set, watching it on TV? Do people think that you are brother and sister? Do you, a lot of people think that's a real thing?
I mean, we look quite different, to be honest.
Yeah, we definitely do have some different eye and hair colour going on. But
I don't think it's much different. For some reason, it just every time I see him, it's like my brother, you know? Yeah, it's not.
The dynamic feels very real.
Yeah.
So tell me something about Itch. What's he like as a person? You tell me yourself, Sam. What are you? The character... What can we expect to get from Itch?
I love Itch. I think he's one of the most self-assured characters I ever have played. He knows what he loves, he's passionate about it, and he will tell everyone about it. Stands up for what he believes in. You know, he's sassy. He works very hard, you know.
The hair's a lot redder in the TV.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
I've got dyed,
I get
dyed. Do you colour your hair? Do you have to colour it? They let you have your own hair.
Yeah, they dye me to a nice auburn. It always takes a few times before they get it to the exact shade they like.
Wow.
Yeah, so I'm in and out of the hair.
I'm just glad to have fake hair. But that's okay. So the character, do you think he's going to grow on people? Do people love Itch or do you find that he's annoying?
Well, I certainly hope people love Itch. I think, you know, the charm of the character is that at the beginning everyone sees him as an outsider, but everyone slowly realises that how steadfast he is in what he believes
and
kind
lovable.
Of, yeah, wears his heart on his sleeve. Yeah. You know, you can't help but root for him. Yeah.
Kiala, tell me about your character, Chloe. How are we going to find her?
Well, she's very sassy, you know. She's very, she likes things her way and she doesn't mind telling people what she's thinking.
Mm-hmm.
She likes bullying Itch as well.
I noticed
have to say.
That. Make my sandwich if you want.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I've heard it all.
Yes, typical brother, older brother, doing what you're told.
That's right.
Are we going to love Kiala as well?
I reckon.
Sounds like we're going to have fun. There's 10 episodes, I believe, of the second series that's been made. Where can we see it, guys? So, I think it's you're going to do it for us, Sam.
I am.
Look at the camera there.
You can see it, at abc.net.au on their website, and you can also catch it on iView at iview.abc.net.au/show/itch.
Now, it's wonderful to have you both in the studio. Can I just say, it's running on the ABC as well. Do you know what night it's on?
It's on, they sort of rerun it unpredictably. Yeah. You know,
so it could be anywhere.
Leave the TV on long enough, we'll pop
usually
up.
Usually in kids' hours as well, if it's a children's TV show.
Yeah.
Are you hoping to move on from Itch one day? Maybe, let's say, something really popular like Neighbours?
Ooh,
Would you like to be? Is there a TV show? Please don't say Home and Away. Is there a show that you, any show, if you could work in anything in television right now, what would you do? Survivor, you know, Big Brother, what would you like to do?
I will say, I was desperate to get on that Amazon Lord of the Rings series.
Really?
I'm a big Lord of the Rings fan. Like really, really that. Big Lord of the Rings fan.
You never know, they're watching.
You never know. Keala?
I don't really have one, to be honest. Just I'm going to see what happens because I'm only young. I'm waiting for what happens. Yeah.
This is a great opportunity. Comics are made the show. It's been distributed by the ABC worldwide. It is an ABC-funded program. We want it to continue. Please watch it as much as you can. Send in feedback to the ABC telling them how much you love it. And we hope there'll be a third series. This is the second series of Itch. Please support these guys. They're local as well. It's been a pleasure having you here.
Pleasure being here.
And thank you for being such wonderful people. And we look forward to seeing more and more from you. And please don't leave Perth if you can avoid it.
Oh,
never.
We'll stick around.
Because you know you won't be allowed back with our restrictions. Thank you very much. Yeah. We're going to take a break. More of The Couch coming up after this. And it's always great to promote local talent. See you then. Welcome back to The Couch. Always nice to promote local talent. We just had some local actors. Now we're talking about a local designer, a local dressmaker, a local artist. They are wonderful people. And to promote the fantastic dress that's won awards and we hope that you can all see very, very soon, is Nisha Seth. Over to you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Fred. Art, culture and history, so important. And integrating this so wonderfully, we have Perth fashion designer Karen Young joining us on The Couch.
Hi,
welcome.
Nisha.
And then we also have Sammy Wyborn, who's a broom artist, joining us.
Hello.
It's so exciting to have you both here to speak about the work that you've been doing together. But first of all, for our audience, Karen, tell us a bit about, I guess, your passion as a fashion designer here in Perth.
Love it, love it. Love Western Australia, my home state. I am an untrained designer, don't have any qualifications there, but simply followed a passion and started a few years ago when I won an Australian Design Award and third in Europe, back in 93, actually.
Wow.
But I let it go for personal reasons and marriage and so forth at that stage.
Life
but
happens,
yeah. Yeah, it does, it does. And then just recently I was selected for a parade at the WA Museum.
Oh, wonderful. So that was the Kaleidoscope World Fashion Event. And
yes.
I believe it was at the museum here in WA, which is beautiful. Yeah,
yes.
Fantastic. And we will see Simone, one of the main models, I guess, of the key garment. And Sammy, you've played a huge role being the artist that has done the actual art on the dress. Tell us a bit about your work and your background.
Thank you. So I am an Aboriginal artist from Broome. All my family are from that area and we've only just recently relocated to Perth. I've painted all my life and stories that have been told to us have just been handed down through generations and now my children paint.
And the expression of your art, you know, working with Karen, what's that meant for you?
Oh, it's incredible. It's something that I've been wanting to do for a long time now and it just so happened that fate played a huge part in this collaboration and it's incredible to, it's like a mummy moment seeing that on stage and being proudly worn by Simone as well.
And this is a great segue to ask Karen about how you both co-created this piece. We can see some of the design work there on the screen.
I started off, because I was chosen for the museum, I had the feeling that I would definitely want to do a West Australian ball gown. And I had the intention of collaborating with Sammy to give it that authenticity. I wanted to give glamour to Aboriginal art. As far as I know, a ball gown has never been done before with Aboriginal art upon it. And West Australia is my home state. I love it. I wanted to express the flora and fauna that we have here, particularly also with the headpiece that I made with the wildflowers upon it. So just the inspiration came with the West Australian feel and then asking Sammy. I found Sammy on Facebook, and it turned out
Facebook
to be the
helps
perfect
us a lot,
match.
Doesn't it? Yes. Great, great. Yeah.
Sammy was just as excited as I was to follow the whole West Australian feel.
Brilliant. And I think I want to pick up on something you said, Sammy, earlier about the importance of storytelling and the generational storytelling, which obviously I think Karen has picked up on as part of the authenticity. What do you hope when you look at the garment? What do you hope? What's the story that you hope that the audience can gain from that?
So the story with that actual garment is it's two worlds coming together. It's two cultures coming together and learning from each other. It's extremely important to learn, I feel, each other's journeys and cultures and what's involved in that history as well. You know, it's very important. I would love that viewers get a sense of that through the dress and can then divulge into our history and understanding of it, and you know, it's just pop in and have a yarn with somebody about it, and it's an amazing thing. I really do enjoy learning from other cultures as well.
Wonderful, it really opens the doors. Absolutely. And Karen, when you hear Sammy talking about the story, it must bring back, I guess, memories of the first part of your co-creation. Watching at the event when you were watching Simone in the beautiful garment, can you talk through, I guess, that
it
experience?
Was extreme. Extremely exciting, something that meant the world to both of us.
Yes.
With the whole, you know, the West Australian feel and the unison of two cultures, myself and Sammy obviously working together in harmony, that meant a great deal to us.
That's wonderful.
So, we were just enlivened by the whole thing and seeing it come together, and we'd put a lot of work into it. So,
wonderful. And I guess generationally, we talk a lot now, particularly around the United Nations space, about diversity being a strength. Are we hoping that this is a really hopeful platform? It's a conversation starter.
100%. And there needs to be a lot more diversity with Indigenous fashion. There are some incredible artists out there and some amazing stories and backgrounds that if that was tuned into, it would be absolutely incredible what would come from that.
Well, we can see how incredible this garment is. There's so many layers of understanding and opportunity. So congratulations to you both.
Thank you.
An exciting question I'm sure our audience are wanting the answer to is, what's happening in the future for you both?
Well, we're looking at some options overseas at the moment, UK and Middle East, following a couple of connections there. But we would love to display this in our home state.
Any ideas on where you're hopeful?
Looking at the WA Museum.
Yes.
Fingers
spot,
crossed.
Perfect spot. Full endorse.
We would love the public to see it.
Yes. Yeah. It would be an absolute shame for that garment not to be available for everyone to see as well. What about yourself, Sammy? Anything extra?
I am actually opening up my own little shop in Guildford soon. Mm-hmm. So the dress will be on display there on the opening night. And, see what comes of that.
I think that's very exciting. Yeah. And so for our viewers who are like, when is that opening night? How do I get an invitation? If you can have a look down our camera one there and just tell us what website or where to find you, basically.
Thank you. So pop over to the website, to my website, www.sammywyborneaboriginalart.net. I'm also on Instagram and Facebook. It's very, very super easy to find me.
You got found earlier, didn't you? I'll find you. Sorry, my silly side came out then. Karen, how do we find you?
I'm soon to release a website, karenelizabethyoung.com.au, but for the time being, everyone seems to be doing the Instagram thing, so I've definitely got photos all over that.
Beautiful.
And Facebook. Under Karen Elizabeth Young too.
Beautiful. Well, Karen and Sammy, lovely to meet you. You've got great energy sitting here on the couch.
Thank you.
Looking forward to having you on maybe in the future with the next co-creation.
Love to. Thank you, Nisha.
Thanks for having
us.
Absolute pleasure. Good luck with the opening.
Thank you.
Now, of course, if you missed any of that, you can go to our Facebook page to check out all those details, or our website, thecouch.com.au. But for now, it's back to you, Fred.
Thank you, Nisha. Thank you to Karen and Sammy as well. The dress is amazing. We've had it here in the studio, as you would have seen, being shown on the set. Beautiful, beautiful dress. I did actually say it reminded me of a very elegant maybe wedding dress down the track. So look, I hope you have great success. Let's hope we get it in the WA Museum. To be there as a West Australian treasure. Fantastic Indigenous art. It's Australian 100%, and we'd love to see it more. And check out their websites, keep in touch, and follow them. And that way you'll know exactly when it's all happening as well. Time now for some music on the couch. We've got young Elvis back centre stage with a wonderful Elvis song. It's called Don't Be Cruel. Here he is.
Well, you know I can be found sitting home all alone. If you can come around, at least please telephone. Don't be cruel to a heart that's true. Maybe if I made you mad, there's something I might have said. Please let's forget the past, the future looks so bright ahead. Don't be cruel to a heart that's true. Well, I don't want no other love, baby, it's still you I'm banging on. Stop thinking of me, don't make me feel this way. Come on over here and love me, and I know what I want you to stay. Don't be cruel to a heart that's true. Well, I don't want no other love, baby, it's still you I'm hanging on. Let's walk up to the preacher and let us say I do. When you know you'll have me, and I know that I'll have you. Don't be cruel to a heart that's true. Well, I don't want no other love, baby, it's still you I'm playing on. Don't be cruel to a heart that's true. Don't be cruel to a heart that's true. Well, I don't want no other love, baby, it's still you I'm thinking of.
Connect with The Couch online through Facebook, Instagram and YouTube.
Welcome back to a very special show today. We've had lots of great guests, lots of local talent. Can I just say West Australian talent? I hope you've enjoyed it all around Australia. We're not stopping that now. We've got another fantastic talent, fresh from his appearances on Telethon 2021. Hello, Alexander Sacosta.
Hello, back. Fred. Thank you very much for having me.
There is lots happening.
Yeah, it's been a sort of very interesting week in entertainment. Well, lots today of ups, lots of downs. Today was sad.
Bert Newton, he would have... We look after people like Bert.
Yeah.
Passed away at the age of 83 with an ongoing illness.
Veteran broadcaster. You couldn't turn on the TV without seeing someone like that. And it's very upsetting to kind of lose an icon.
Yeah,
like
look,
that.
Very, very sad. Condolence with the family and condolence to everybody who loves Bert, because I think it's everyone.
Yeah, he's like the grandfather of Australian television.
Correct. And I said to someone, there's not many of us left now.
Oh, Fred, we still got you.
That's true.
Yeah, we've still got you.
Thank you, Alexander. If you don't mind, fill in for me if I have to go early.
Oh, no, I would never take your spot.
No, of course not. I do agree with you. You've got a point. But I tell you what, Keanu Reeves has got a point. What's happening
My
with him?
My good friend Keanu Reeves.
Yes. Is he driving a bus?
No. Yes, he can't let it go below. No, that's just a movie. But he's actually known as the nicest guy in Hollywood. Not in that shot there, obviously. That's
How
a movie.
Would you know? Have
you
met
John
him?
Wick. I haven't met him, but the stories that you get from him, just strangers on the street. And now, another story, doesn't publicise it, gave each of the stuntmen from his recent film John Wick Chapter 4 Rolexes worth $13,000 Australian.
Wow.
Rolexes, Fred.
Better than Australia Post.
What do you get at Christmas time? What was the gift you got?
Nothing.
Nothing. I got
nothing.
A letter that said I'm fired.
I get a hamper.
A hamper.
From
a broken
Channel 9.
Watch.
I love the Channel 9 hamper.
Thank you, Channel 9.
Thank
or
you.
Another network someone else could be on who might be sitting here.
Beautiful
anyway.
Hamper.
I've heard, though, that, like, I actually think that he's so nice that even if he, like, stabbed me, his last words would probably be, like, You're what a wonderful guy, Alexander.
So the story, the gist of the Keanu Reeves story,
yes.
Following this, he gave out some amazingly expensive watches to stunt people. And did he do it for a reason or just because he's a beautiful guy?
No, because he's a good guy. He actually gave Harley Davidson's to the stuntmen on The Matrix.
And what's this? He reports claiming that he's given away more than
$125 million. He didn't report it. They reported it. $125 million.
News.com.au.
So he reduces down his salary so everyone else on the set is paid more.
Wealthy man, he can do it, unlike you and me. We'd be broke. We'd be. Could you imagine us giving Rolexes?
Yeah.
It'd have to be the ones made in Bali, I think.
Yeah, the one with the two L's.
Thank you. True. What's happening with Alec Baldwin? Tragic, what happened?
This is a very upsetting story. So obviously there's been throughout history instances on sets where people have accidentally used live ammunition, which has then unfortunately gone off.
I know of, I think, two.
Yeah.
Kung Fu, what's Bruce Lee's son?
Bruce Lee's son, that's right.
They got killed accidentally with the gun was
loaded.
And
the movie The Crow, yeah.
I have to ask, this is some of the footage that we're looking at.
Yeah.
How do they get that wrong?
You know, there's all these like protocols in place. And like anything in risk management, if everything aligns incorrectly, accidents happen. But you kind of think that to still be using live ammunition on sets, like it's actually quite common practice. A lot of people think they're complete prop guns. They're not. Mm. They use real weapons.
Well, apparently about an hour before they used the gun, they were all mucking around with it, shooting bottles.
Well, the stories have all started to come out now, so I think it's very hard to know what is truth when it comes to this, because everyone's going to have an opinion
what
as
is
to who's
true
responsible.
Is one of the DPs has passed
has
away.
Has passed away.
And another one was injured.
And, yeah, the director themselves was also injured.
And can we just tell people as well, I think if I got this correct, Alec Baldwin's actually the executive producer. Or
And
the worst thing that came out of this is they've got no insurance, apparently.
Really?
True. I heard this on the news a couple of days ago. I don't know. It must be fact if they're reporting it, but there was no insurance. So I was saying to somebody, well, looks like Alec Baldwin will be having
liable
deep,
as well.
Deep pockets. So if not only does he have the memory of this, he may have the financial burden as well.
Well, and it shuts down production. It changes everything, all these people's jobs. It's just, a tragedy.
Not
through
good.
And through. Not good at all.
And what's happening with Squid Game? So, I got to watch one episode.
What did you think of it?
I'll be honest. Yeah. It was crap. look, the thing that says
no, but
green,
be honest. What did you think of it?
Green, red.
Right, yeah.
Look, the killing of so many people. It's very violent.
Yes, it is.
I will say it's pretty brutal, pretty violent. I'm pretty sure kids will love it because it looks like a game that you'd watch on the TV.
Yes.
But I just think it was... For now, I'm going to watch another episode, just not to misjudge it.
Not to misjudge it. Yeah,
it's one of the most famous shows, isn't it?
Well, that's the thing with Netflix. It's going to potentially be the biggest hit they've ever had as a show. And the director was saying about, since he had signed an initial contract to make that show, he's not going to get any extra money because it's become a hit. And that's how it works with Netflix. They buy... and then you're not owed bonuses or back-end deals or anything like that. And I think that's what's so interesting with Netflix, because I actually think they're actually in a position to choose what is the next best thing.
Correct.
Because if they publicise it more, then it becomes the next thing.
And this is sort of like the Hunger Games type
thing. It's not...
Hunger Games with an English voiceover.
Well, yeah, if you watch the dub version,
So is it Korean, isn't it?
Yes, it is Korean.
Korean.
Yeah.
Because I saw a Hyundai in one of the backgrounds. And I thought, oh, wow.
Product placement.
Look, it looks like they've spent a lot of money on it, but it's not something I would
none of that money
watch.
Went to the director.
No, not good, is it? So there you go. Was there anything else about this?
No,
Squid Game?
It's just upsetting.
Bachelorette 21. Does anyone still watch the
Bachelorette? Well, that's the thing. Unfortunately, the latest season, which actually has a Perth.
Isn't there like a lesbian twist?
She's about bisexual. So she goes both ways. And it wasn't enough to bolster the audience numbers. So they still only had 397,000 Metro viewers across the country, which is the lowest for a Bachelorette
series. I did see it on
series.
The promo, which sort of...
What?
Not quite like... It wasn't quite like that, but you know what I mean.
Well, that's the thing. And I think if I wanted to watch a show with kind of all these people who have narcissistic egos are just standing around trying to one-up each other, I just watch, like, Question Time on the ABC.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. It's shorter as well. It only goes for an hour.
Yeah.
But, interesting. I think the youth of today, being the modern world that we're in, the non-politically correct world
we're in,
it could be anyone, anything. And I guess, why wouldn't there be a bisexual
woman? But I don't think you have to use it so much, like, as a tokenistic way to try to sell the show. Yep. It should just be normalised.
Now, tributes flow into the ABC announcement.
Another very upsetting thing.
Nice man, Russell Wolf passed away.
That's right. Legend of ABC radio, veteran broadcaster over decades. The Drive
he did the Breakfast Show
in
as well.
America. Did the Breakfast Show with Nani Mitsopoulos as well.
Yep.
I think what was a beautiful quote from his was, there he is there, was about how famous people can tell famously good stories, and they're great, but do you know what's even better? Regular people being encouraged to tell their own unique stories.
Look, he was a lovely man. Yeah. I only met him on Instagram, and yeah. that's how nice he was. He'd always check in and say, how are you going? How are you, Fred? He knew you as genuine. A person. Very genuine. He used to do the breakfast show, like you said, with Nadia. Yeah. This year, they've moved him to his own.
Yeah.
And can I just say, working on opposition stations, ABC and 6PR, he actually beat us in a couple of the ratings. So he was doing really, really well.
Yeah.
Can I just say, he will be missed,
yes.
Especially here in WA. He had the little motto on the show, we'll take you there.
Yeah.
And that's him.
Yeah.
Wolfie, they used to call him. And such a wonderful man. Did you ever remember him on the ABC doing the weather?
I don't remember him doing the
weather. Yeah, that's where he started. He was a weatherman, just a simple person, a nice guy, family man. He had a lovely daughter and a wife.
Mm.
And he will be sadly missed. Mm. He died suddenly in his sleep. There's not much more to it. And, we pay tribute to him as well,
so
Russell.
It's been a bit of a sad, sad week.
That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Fred.
On that note.
Yes.
This is our last segment for the year for you.
Oh, and forever? No. Is this a Squid Game situation? We are not
a Channel 7, you know. But no, look, thank you for all your great work. We still want work there. So thank you very much. We'll keep following you on Home in WA. Hopefully you're still there. And anything else, any television producers, here's your man. Give him a job presenting for you. Even the weather maybe on Channel 9, you never know. That is it. I'm being wound up. Thanks to the crew. Thanks to Tyre. Thanks to all our fabulous people that came on the show today. We're going to leave you with a little bit of Elvis. And he ain't nothing but a hound dog. Do you really want him to sing? Or can I sing? No, they were saying yes. Here he is. Keep smiling. Bye for now. We'll see you next week.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog. You croaky all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. You croaky all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend. Well, they said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. You know, you said you was high class. Just a lie. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. You croaky all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. You croaky all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend. Oh my. Just a lie. You know you said you was high class. Well, that was just a lie. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit and you ain't no friend. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. You croaky all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. You croaky all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit. You ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, cracking all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, cracking all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit, you ain't no friend. You ain't nothing but nothing but a hound dog, cracking all the time. Well, you ain't never caught a rabbit, you ain't no friend of mine.
Thank you. Thank you very much.